In the spring of 1752, while the beaux tittered and raised their glasses to Mary Blandy, who'd poisoned her father for opposing her marriage, another case that had been pending came to trial, and the newspapers throbbed with horror that a second parricide lady should have been exposed. A bill for the prevention of the horrid crime of murder was about to go before Parliament. Hanging was laid down for so many trivial crimes that it seemed necessary to distinguish wilful homicide as more heinous than stealing 5 shillings. And some commentators now seriously suggested that parricides might well be burned alive rather than hanged. At first sight, the crime of Elizabeth Jeffreys did seem peculiarly despicable. The father whose death she plotted was adoptive. Childless Joseph Jeffreys and his wife longed for an infant of their own, and in 1732 his brother Thomas, a Shropshire boat builder with a large family, consented to make over his little daughter Elizabeth to be brought up by the benevolent couple. They did their best for her. They tried to educate her in the graces and accomplishments appropriate to the adopted daughter of a prosperous retired butcher in the rural retreat of Walthamstow. But as the years passed by, and Elizabeth reached her teens, her bad character came to the fore. In 1742 she was 15, and it became clear that she preferred the card table to the library. Worse, she was already a hardened drinker. Worse still, on a trip to London, she met a dashing army officer in a tavern on Tower Hill, ogled him, and had retired to a private room in hope of a lusty debauch, only to be disappointed when the filthy state of her chemise convinced him that he would not be her only recent sexual partner, and he refused to run the risk of contracting a noxious ailment. Good Mrs. Jeffreys probably never learned about this escapade, though her daughter must have been a sad disappointment to her when she died a couple of years later. Mr. Jeffreys now tried to bring Elizabeth to her senses by lavishing affectionate attention on her and making her his principal heir. He made a will, leaving her £1,000 clear, his houses and furniture in Walthamstow and the city, and the residue of his estate, after trifling legacies to other nephews and nieces, had been paid. Elizabeth did not obviously reform, nor did she adequately replace her dead foster mother as a housekeeper. Around 1748, Mr. Jeffreys was forced to extend his household by the acquisition of 2 servants, a maid, Sarah Armstrong, and a man called John Swan as general factotum. Elizabeth lost no time in seducing Swan. By the end of 1750, their intimate liaison was apparent to Mr. Jeffreys, who disapproved. As the year advanced, he threatened to cut Elizabeth out of his will if she continued to make an indecent spectacle of herself. By early summer, Elizabeth feared that she would soon make an indisputably pregnant spectacle, and her rich inheritance seemed to be melting before her eyes. She was no more willing to renounce Swan than she was to lose the money, but neither of the lovers was willing to take immediate personal action to dispose of the old man. Instead, they approached a poor man called Matthews, who had been employed by Mr. Jeffreys for 1 week to help Swan with the garden. This tatterdemalion seemed desperate enough to carry out any nefarious plan for them, and Swan beckoned him into a garden shed to ask furtively whether he would knock his employer over the head for him. Elizabeth added her arguments, saying she could never be happy until that old miser, her uncle, was dead. Matthews hesitated, but was obviously tempted by the promise of £100, possibly rising to £700 as he still demurred. A decision to change the murder weapon from a cudgel to a pair of pistols seems to have taken place in May, when Swan went down to London and met Matthews at the Bell Inn in Petticoat Lane. The two were so noisy and Matthews so ragged that the landlord searched them and had them arrested on suspicion of being highwaymen when Swan proved to be carrying heavy pistols. Elizabeth had to leave Walthamstow at 4 a.m. and take a carriage into town to rescue her accomplices from the Bridewell, giving the explanation that the pistols were newly bought and Swan had been sent to town to have them cleaned. On July the 3rd, 1751, the plan came to fruition. At 2 a.m, several of Mr. Jeffreys' neighbours heard shots. At 2:45, they were all woken up by Elizabeth hanging out of her bedroom window in her shift, screaming fire and murder. Swan came to the door in his shirt, announcing in some confusion that the house had been robbed and he feared Mr. Jeffreys had been murdered. Elizabeth threw herself out of the upstairs window and scrambled to the ground, twisting her ankle as she did so. Her neighbours, like the gallant captain of Tower Hill, noticed with some distaste that her shift was very soiled. She told them that she'd seen four men going downstairs, saying that they'd done all the harm they could and now intended to set the house on fire. She feared her father's throat had been cut. It hadn't, but two shots had been fired into his head, the second from a brittle bullet, which had fragmented, making a third deep cut under his ear, which was at first believed to be a knife wound. Mr. Jeffreys was not yet dead, but he could neither speak nor understand questions. A slight pressure of the hand, indicating that he was aware of sympathetic friends around, was all he could manage, and by 8 o'clock he passed away. Elizabeth searched the house and reported some plate was missing. Swan energetically armed a party with rakes, and they went to drag the pond, where the missing silver was found in a sack. A window beside the back door had been broken, allowing room for an arm to sneak in and shoot the door bolt. The whole murderous robbery seemed to explain itself. Those neighbours who remembered Ragged Matthews wondered whether he might not have been a party to it. He'd been seen around the house again that day. Elizabeth and Swan promptly contradicted each other. One said that Matthews might well know something about the matter and he'd better be looked for. The other said that Matthews was undoubtedly innocent and questioning him would only bring down trouble on the whole household. Nor was this the only suspicious circumstance. Those neighbours who remembered hearing shots wondered why on earth it had taken Elizabeth 3/4 of an hour to raise the alarm. The murder weapon was obviously one of Mr. Jeffreys' own pistols, which were usually kept hanging in the kitchen. One was now missing, but Sarah Armstrong had watched Swan in the kitchen that very night, shaping lead bullets to fit it and loading it. Shavings of lead on the tiled floor confirmed her story. But it was the broken window that really gave the plot away. It was one of those picturesque casements with tiny leaded diamond panes. The hole had been made with all the care of a fine glazier who wanted to ensure that the removal of glass would not entail breakage, and all could be made good again with ease. The leading was carefully rolled away unbroken from the inside. A search for Matthews ultimately succeeded, and he confessed to his part in the plot. On the night of July the 3rd, Swan and Elizabeth had handed him the pistol and told him to blow the old man's brains out. Faced with such stark reality, he refused. They cajoled him and offered increasing sums of money. They threatened to kill him on the spot, but finally they told him to go away and never come back. Only, however, after they made him take a solemn oath never to reveal a word of their complicity. He took it, but with the reservation that he could reveal all if his own life was in danger. Naturally, Matthews became a star prosecution witness. The trial was delayed long enough that Elizabeth's supposed pregnancy proved unreal. She would be hanged now for sure, provided her trial contained no legal error, and few of her contemporaries thought hanging a severe enough penalty for her, and they continued to believe her a monster of depravity, even though the court proceedings and the prisoner's confessions after they'd been sentenced to death revealed an extraordinary state of affairs, casting a quite different light on the murder. Today we should have no hesitation in condemning Mr. Jeffreys as a villain and pitying Elizabeth as his victim. For the marks of adolescent depravity she evinced were the direct consequence of his having incestuously corrupted her. When she was 15, she found herself pregnant, and the old man simply hustled her out of the way to Portsmouth, where by good fortune she miscarried. A year later she conceived again. By this time the deceived Mrs. Jeffreys was dead, and Joseph refused to lose a gestation period of his niece's embraces. He procured her an abortifacient and retained her at home to continue sleeping with him, even as she miscarried. Astonishingly, the moralists of 1752 took this distressing incident as evidence that the child was already a murderess long before she reached adult years. Once he was widowed, the old lecher made little attempt to conceal his intimacy with his adopted daughter. Her evil reputation in the neighbourhood undoubtedly had more to do with the questionable position in which she had been put than any abnormal appetite for cards and strong waters. The generous legacy was a mere sweetener to keep her docile and stop her flying back to her innocent natural parents in Shropshire. And it was Sarah Armstrong rather than John Swan who'd brought a most unhappy situation to a festering head, for the old man took a fancy to her as well. Elizabeth found the two in bed together and felt hopelessly betrayed. Sarah's wages mysteriously increased. Her clothes became altogether finer and more fashionable than one would expect in an Epping servant. She was evidently becoming Mr. Jeffrey's first love, and Elizabeth began to fear that having been ruined morally and emotionally, she might be ruined financially as well if Mr. Jeffrey's altered his will in Sarah's favour and sent her back to Shropshire in unspecified disgrace, confident, like so many child abusers, that his victim's misplaced guilt and shame would conceal his own crime adequately. In this situation, John Swan seemed like a white knight come to the rescue. Her passion for him was untouched by the stain of incest. And still Mr. Jeffreys insisted that Elizabeth must be his when he wanted. It was clear that many of the occasions when Elizabeth had tried to persuade neighbours to take him out and get him drunk at the tavern were caused by her hope that he might come home too stupefied to ravish her again, and not, as had been alleged, to set him up for previous murder attempts. It was even said that he forced her into his bed early on the night when the fictitious burglary took place. Swan, of course, did the actual shooting. He confessed to it. But it is a startling consideration that the 18th century actually hanged and strongly wanted to burn alive a woman whom we should almost certainly have given a suspended sentence and a course of sympathetic psychotherapy.